Hi, I'm Chris, part of Splunk's education team. Splunk's DB Connect bridges your Splunk instance to relational databases, enabling use of Splunk queries and reports. In this demonstration, we'll add DB Connect to a Splunk instance. We'll connect it to a database, ingest data, perform searches, and even create a lookup to enrich our search results. Finally, we'll output Splunk statistical data back to the database. Please note that setting up Splunk DB Connect will require a Splunk administrator account. This video covers settings to use when installing DB Connect in a single server deployment. If you're working in a distributed environment, please see the documentation for details. For this demonstration, we'll pretend we're a gaming company called Buttercup Games. We recently purchased a game called Grand Theft Scooter, along with its database of sales and user information. We want to ingest data from Grand Theft Scooter's database into our local Splunk instance. Let's see how we'll use the DB Connect app to work with this structured data. We start by installing the app. For Splunk DB Connect to work, we must use Splunk Enterprise version 6 or greater. We also need version 8 of the Java Development Kit and a supported database driver. We'll talk more about these later. First, we log into our Splunk Enterprise instance. From the Home app, we click on the Gear in the App menu and select Browse More Apps. We search for the Splunk DB Connect app. We click Install and enter our user credentials for Splunk.com. Please note, this is not our Splunk Enterprise instance login, but rather our credentials for the Splunk.com website. We accept terms and conditions, then click the Login and Install button. We are asked to restart Splunk. Once it is rebooted, we log back in. We click on the Splunk logo and click Splunk DB Connect in the app sidebar. A pop-up box will ask if we would like Splunk to collect information about our usage in the app. We click OK and click Setup to begin. We're taken to the General tab of DB Connect Settings interface. We've already installed the Java platform and verified the path to the home directory. We enter the path into the JRE installation path field. This path is unique to your environment, so you'll need to verify the path for your server. We click Save. An alert window appears as Splunk restarts the task server. While it does, the JVM options field automatically fills with our server settings. Once the task server restarts, we click OK. Now, we need to set up drivers for the database in the Drivers tab. We are using a PostgreSQL database, and we need to install a driver for it. Since all database drivers are different, check out the documentation for information about your specific database. In this example, we've already downloaded the driver. To make it available to DB Connect, we move it to the driver directory inside the DB Connect app's root directory. Going back to the Drivers tab, we click Reload and see a green checkmark. Our driver is now installed. The Logging and Usage Collection tabs are worth mentioning. These options can help you troubleshoot your database connections and ultimately make the DB app better. Let's click on the Databases menu and Identities tab. Before we can connect to the database, we must have an identity to make the connection. We click New Identity and enter a name. We enter the username and password that we use to access our database. If we were using a Microsoft SQL Server database, we check the Use Windows Authentication Domain box. We click Save. Permissions are outside the scope of this video, but do note that there are restrictions and privileges that can be adjusted to your environment. Now we create a connection for Splunk to use. We click the Connections tab, then the New Connection button. First, we enter a connection name. In the drop-down menu, we choose our identity, connection type, and time zone. we enter the database's host. We'll type in our GTS database as our default. A preview of the JDBC URL is available on the right, which can be edited if needed. We won't enable SSL in this example, but we strongly recommend this option in a production environment. You can also set your connection to be read-only. The fetch size is 100 rows by default. We can leave it blank or enter the number of rows we want returned at a time from the database. We click Save. Great! Now we see a table of in-game sessions from the GTS database. We would like to search, run statistics, and create reports on this data. Let's ingest it into Splunk by going to the Data Lab menu and clicking the Input tab. We click the New Input button. In the Set SQL Query interface, we choose a table to ingest into our Splunk instance. In this example, we select the GTS DB connection that we just created. We choose the catalog, schema, and table to use. Here, we are selecting the table called Sessions. Once we select it, DB Connect runs a query and displays data from the table. On the right, we can use a predefined template for our input, or set it to be a certain type. We can select a batch input or rising column. Batch simply repeats the same query, indexing all the table's data every time it runs. A rising column uses a checkpoint, such as a sequential ID, with checkpoint values that update each time the input is run. This means DB Connect can keep track of what rows are new from one input execution to the next, and will only ingest the new data. We select the rising column input. We now are shown steps to take and a suggested SQL query to use. We choose ID as our rising column. As we do, the example query updates with our choice. The interface lets us know that we need to update our SQL query to accept the checkpoint value using a question mark variable. Use the WHERE command to filter the column, and sort the results using ORDER BY. We can use the example query supplied by DB Connect. Every time this query is run, DB Connect will replace the question mark with the latest checkpoint value, returning only rows with an ID greater than the checkpoint value. To see this in action, if we select ID as the checkpoint column, enter 5 as the checkpoint value, and click Execute SQL, it returns rows starting at the ID of 6. Of course, we will want to ingest all of the data, so we set our checkpoint value to 0. Now, when we run the SQL query, we'll see all the rows being returned, starting at row 1. Splunk requires a timestamp to index data. You can choose to have Splunk create a timestamp using index time, or select a column to use. In this case, we can use the time column. We enter its format. By default, the SQL query will have 30 seconds to complete before timing out, but we can specify any length of time. We click Next. In Set Properties, we name and describe the input, and select the app context. We determine the maximum number of rows to retrieve per query. The fetch size sets how many rows of data to return at a time. For execution frequency, we want to enter how often the input will run in seconds. We could also use a valid cron expression here. We enter a host name, source, and source type, and select the index to use. Finally, we click Finish. Now that we're ingesting data, let's run a search. We'll go to the search menu in the Splunk bar. We now have statistics showing how many units sold by product ID. It would be helpful to know the name of the products and how much these unit sales amount to. Luckily, we have another table in our database with product name and price information. We can correlate the data from our database to Splunk by creating a lookup. We click on the Data Lab menu again, go to the Lookups tab, and click New Lookup. We enter a reference search, including the fields we want to map to our lookup, and click Next. Now, we create the lookup SQL by selecting our connection. We choose a catalog, schema, and table again. This time, we select Product, which has the product names and prices we need. Once chosen, data is returned from the table. On the right, the reference search fields and database columns appear. We see that the products table contains product names and prices. That's the info we need, so we click Next. Now, we're going to map the columns in the database table to our data in Splunk by using field mapping. We're telling Splunk that the PID column in the products table is the same as the PID field in our Splunk data. Then, we select the columns in the table to output as new Splunk fields. We choose to return name as product name, and price as product price. Preview results shows us a Splunk processing language command. Below it is an option to check our settings by using it in a new search. Everything looks good, so we click Next. We now name the lookup, describe it, and choose DB Connect as its application context. The DBX lookup command appears in the summary. We'll add it to our query to enrich our search. Our lookup is complete. To get results, you will need to explicitly reference input fields in our search. We can do this using the fields command or running searches in verbose mode. Before, our search only showed a count of purchases by product ID numbers. With a DBX lookup command, we can return the product names, how many units sold, and the revenue for each. Not only can we get statistical information from our database, we can also write this information back to it. Here, we are finding how much each user has spent on in-game purchases. The product team would like to use this data in the game, and has asked us to populate a database table with it. We go to the Outputs tab, and click New Output. We start our output by repeating our previous search. Then we click Next. Select the destination table for our data output. The table schema preview shows us the table's existing columns. We'll have to map fields from our returned events to these columns. Let's do that next. The UID field will correlate to the UID column in our database, and the spend field will map to our spend column. We check the upsert box and choose user ID as our key. If we're mapping to a row that already exists in the intended table, upsert will update that row. If a new UID appears in the returned event, it's added to the table. We click Next. We name our output, add a description, and choose our context. Once again, we have a query timeout input to set the query's duration in seconds before timing out. We click the Schedule button and schedule how frequently the output will occur. Then we click Finish. If we go back to our database, we can see that DB Connect has exported data into our user spend table. Now, we have Grand Theft Scooter data in Splunk, we have a lookup, and we've sent Splunk statistical data back to our external database. For additional information on DB Connect, check out the documentation. While you're at it, view some of the other videos on our channel and sign up for our education courses at splunk.com. If you have suggestions for other video topics, please email howtovideos@splunk.com. Thanks for watching, and happy Splunking!